again, and welcome back to Southeast Texas Weekly. I'm Kevin Steele. Great having you along for the ride today. Over here with a substantive analysis of the political scene on the far right of this table, but not in your hearts and minds, Kent Walston with Brannick Walston and DeVenzio, a strong liberal leader at times. Kind of moderate a lot of times. Also joining us today, Shane Howard, the Jefferson County Tax Assessor Collector, and
Rick Perry.
James Shannon with the Beaumont Business Journal, and that's our key issue to begin with today, is The Gap by Rick Perry.
Key issue.
It was always it's always the third part that gets you. Does that sink the presidential hopes of Rick Perry?
Well, he's got $17 million in the bank, and he can put up a lot of messages where that don't rely on his ability to articulate a thought. So, no, you know, politics is in large part propaganda. And if I got $17 million in my pocket, I can convince a lot of people of darn near anything.
We'd be friends
for life. He's not dead, but he's in critical condition
as far as
his campaign.
Critical?
Yeah, $17 million versus a half billion that the president's, you know, already raised from a bunch of rich
and you get that money from being charismatic and
well, yeah, exactly.
Friends.
Except, I mean, the president makes as many. I mean, he actually makes pretty substantive gaffes, and you know, I'm not going to sit here and harp on that. We know for a fact, President or Governor Barry did not.
How many states are there, after all?
In substance, what he was talking about.
By way of gaffes,
we all have mental freezes at moments. It's not a big deal.
Terrifies me every time I come on this show. Am I going to forget something?
It does happen. I felt actually badly.
No, it doesn't.
But it's a presidential candidate. It's
in a 30-second soundbite type of debate. I mean, things happen. It's not that big of a deal. It happened to then Senator Obama. It continues to happen to him on a very frequent basis, and we don't worry about it.
A president who will have to turn to Ron Paul for the answer to the question that he is trying to
say? And we don't have 57 states, and in the Kansas tornadoes a few years ago, we didn't have 50,000 people die. I mean, we focus on this stuff. For some reason, it always seems to come down to the intelligence
of the substance. Yeah.
But I think you have to look at this holistically, and I think people are judging him as a candidate by all these gaffes, and can he be president with all these gaffes? And that seems to be the problem.
That's fair.
You actually think it's survivable with $17 million in the bank and on hand?
I think I agree with James. Right. With that much money, you can convince almost everybody, except for Mr. Howard.
You know, it's funny how this question became for Shane an opportunity to bash the president. What I worry about with Rick Perry is not what he says; it's what we know he does. You know, don't listen to what we say. Watch what we do.
That is.
Do we apply the same thing to the president then as well?
Well, sure we do.
Okay.
He obviously won a national election.
I know.
Election.
I do. I'm actually a pretty objective observer of these things. I have a certain value set that I look at my candidates through. But certainly, I've always been willing to give President Obama a chance. And what I look at is the fact that he has a set of policies. The question is, can he make the case? And he's certainly going to have enough money to do so, and he demonstrates that on a pretty daily basis as he goes to $37,000 a plate dinners with rich Wall Street folks that then he goes out and bashes to get people ginned up to vote for him.
But he's very articulate, and he can handle the media.
He is sometimes articulate.
He's very articulate.
Sometimes he is, as is Perry sometimes. I mean, that's not the point. The point is what is going on in this country? What are the policies and ideas that are going to move us forward out of the mess that we're in, which were created over a series of decades through a failed set of ideology and policy sets that has to do with giving each other people's money and controlling marketplaces.
But this thing started in the Bush administration. You and I both.
No, it started decades ago.
Yes, it did.
It started decades ago. Yes, it went on through President Bush
as
well.
Yes, it did.
I'm not looking for a Republican, Democrat, Bush, Obama.
They're both
at
fault.
To me, it's a set of ideas that has failed, and it's not capitalism or the marketplace it has. It's control freaks in Washington who pick and choose winners and losers and decide who's going to give money and who will receive money.
You're just mad about the Christmas tree tax.
Which was summarily dismissed after being raised by the administration. What happened to the Christmas tree? You have to make money. Why not on Christmas?
I don't want to get involved in this kind of minutia, but here's my problem, Shane. You're a Republican elected official. We're talking about the GOP primary, but all you want to do is attack the president. Let's address this group of bumblers and bozos y'all've got running over
there. James, let's defend James, them one by one.
What I'm
and
doing,
Perry,
not,
no wait, let me, no, you're let me tell you my point about Perry.
What I'm actually doing is saying that this is a worthless conversation generally, and the amount of, you want to talk about minutia, the amount of time the media has spent on this and the fact that it would kill a presidential campaign potentially, that, and when other people like our president get away with absolutely much more substantive gaffes on a pretty frequent basis, I'm saying either be objective about it or don't bring it up, laugh it off, make it part of the funny segment of the news, and then move on down the road.
Let me bring this point forward. Let me bring this point forward on our veterans. Shane, I know that you are an Air Force veteran, having served in Desert Storm, Desert Shield.
Yeah.
On this Veterans Day weekend, are we treating our veterans with in the way that an honorable nation would treat its veterans?
No, I don't think so, and I don't think we have probably ever. And if people remember, after World War I, there were riots by veterans, you know, that have been sold out by the government, and after the Civil War, as a matter of fact, as well.
In fact, two of the people that fired on the bonus marchers were young Army officers named Eisenhower and MacArthur. You know, that's the tide of history, and the tide of history shifts. And by World War II, after the war, you had the GI Bill. You had essentially the creation of the middle class, all those millions of veterans.
We are not where we need to be with the way that we take care of veterans in this country. And, you know, while there are certain things that we do a great job of.
You agree as well.
I'm a veteran, too, and I certainly agree that we could do more.
Yeah.
But, you know, I'm where I'm at today in life because I served in the military.
Yes.
You know, I got to go to school. I got to go to law school, all because of the military.
Yeah.
And that was a great benefit for me. So I think we could do more, but, you know, I don't think that we're terrible to the military.
No, we're not terrible. I'm pointing out that for all of the vulnerables that we talk about in society, the one that we tend to go and get a lot of applause for with our words and not necessarily through our deeds is with our veterans. And I mean, that's a group of people that offer to give their life potentially and ought to receive some additional things in exchange.
But let me tell you, here on this Veterans Day, I think this is a worthy discussion. The reason for that is there's no sense of shared sacrifice. 1% of the American population serve in the military. So we've been fighting these wars for 10 years, and you know, granted, there's more in the southern and midwestern states, but by and large, one out of 100. If you don't know somebody that's personally invested in that war,
well, shop and travel, I think, is what we're told.
But you're not arguing necessarily for a compulsory service, are you?
I'm trying to explain the reason the veterans are getting short shrift is because they're 1% of the population. The other 99% of us, you know, mouth platitudes, but I don't know that we're willing.
But look at the difference between the Vietnam War and where we're at now. You know, when they came home from the Vietnam War, they were spat upon, they were baby killers.
That is, okay.
We've come
that's
a long
a lie.
Way.
That is an apocryphal story that has never been documented.
That's actually not true. I've got two uncles, a Marine and a former Army Ranger, that will tell you to this day. I mean, from my childhood, one went off to Alaska and basically took solitude there. The other still deals with emotional issues to this day, primarily not just the experiences that they had there, and the confusing political leadership of that war, but then when they came home, to come home to just absolutely
But they weren't spat upon. Show me one documentation. I've researched that for a long time. One of the problems, one of the reasons the returning vets encountered hostility from Vietnam, guess where they came into? San Francisco, Oakland, Berkeley,
sure.
Perhaps the most politicized anti-war.
You know what,
but
they didn't get
spit on. That is an apocryphal story that has been spread
that's
by
fair.
People
Oakland,
that think it's the you know, makes the case. It's not
the,
true.
Occupy
the Berkeley crowd has a habit of burning and breaking things and hurting people. That's
and we'll
true.
Talk about the allegations against presidential candidate Herman Cain. Serious allegations that have arisen this week. That and more when Southeast Texas Weekly continues.